மொபைல் இல்லையா? சரி மீட்டிங் ஐடி சொல்றேன், பவர் போட்டுங்க. ஆ ஜாயின் மீட்டிங் கொடுங்க. एट टू सेवन टू वन सेवन थ्री जीरो वन सेवन थ्री हाँ टू वन सेवन थ्री जीरो वन सेवन थ्री பாஸ்வேர்ட் ஏஐசிடிஇ எஸ்டிடிபி ஒன்
ஹலோ
மைக் டெஸ்டிங் 1 2 3
மைக் டெஸ்டிங் 1 2 3
கேக்குதா? ஓவர் ஓவர் நான் பேசுற கேக்குதா?
நானு
தெளிவா இருக்கு.
ஓகே
ஓகேவா? சரி இப்போ என்ன பண்றீங்களா? உங்களை வந்து ஹோஸ்டா மாத்துறேன்.
மாத்தி ஸ்கிராஷ் சி அதன ஷேர் ஸ்கிரீன் எப்படி பண்ணனும்?
அங்க இருக்கும் பாருங்க, அந்த ஏரோ ஷேர் ஸ்கிரீன் இருக்கும் பாருங்க, மியூட் ஸ்டார்ட் வீடியோ அதுக்கு அப்புறம் இருக்கும் பாருங்க.
இல்ல பிபிஎஸ் போடவா பிபிடி ஏ போட்டுக்கலாமான்னு
கேக்குறேன். எதை வேணா போடுங்க, எதை வேணா ஓபன் பண்ணிக்கலாம். நீங்க ஓபன் பண்ணி வச்சிட்டு ஸ்கிரீன்ல உங்க ஸ்கிரீனை ஷேர் பண்ணுங்க.
And I hope I am audible.
Yes, madam, your voice is audible. No issues. You can continue,
yeah.
ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. So, welcome participants. In this session, we are going to see about overview of Hadoop architecture. So, the agenda that is covered here is big data and analytics. Why big data and what is the need for big data? What all we can do with big data? And what are the problems we have in big data and why we go for Hadoop, its evolution, what is Hadoop, the architecture of Hadoop including HDFS, MapReduce and YARN, and finally Hadoop ecosystem. So since this is an overview of Hadoop architecture, we shall start why we need Hadoop, then we will get into the architectural components. So what is big data and what is the benefit of having big data? So as you all are familiar, big data is the king in today's internet technology. So we have data everywhere and that data is used by many management for taking profitable decisions. So we have effective storage systems that reduces cost, then you can make decisions faster. So the corporates can use this big data to predict their future profits. It also provides an analysis over the data and thereby they can make the decisions. Then you have the moving towards the next generation products. So there are many opportunities towards next generation products. Then you also have improved services or products. So with the advent of big data and its analytics, we have n number of applications that predict the future and make the corporate team to be more benefited. So while coming to big data, we have the characteristics of big data to be represented as V's. So we normally know that three V's represent big data: volume, variety, veracity. Apart from that, we have also have number of V's added together depending upon the definitions. So when we consider the volume, variety and velocity of big data, we know that our traditional approach is what is used for handling the data, that is our normal databases, or we can say relational database management systems. So all the normal databases which we have will not be enough to store the data which is coming under huge volume, which is coming within a second or a minute, and also which is of variety, different structures. Okay, so here what is the problem we face with big data? So as I have told you, you have massive amount of data, so there are storage is huge, so you cannot have that huge storage in normal day-to-day traditional databases. And also when you concentrate with the structure of the big data, so big data is having complex structures. It may be structured, unstructured, or semi-structured. So variety of data what you consider as big data will be different, and we have heterogeneous data for processing. So processing such complex structure will be a problem with traditional approach. Traditional approach, what I mean here is with the normal RDBMS structures. Then the processing or accessing speed, what we have with big data. So it is coming with velocity. So these three V's gives you a problem in handling big data, where we go for another framework or another type of processing infrastructure that can store the big data and process it for fruitful results. So here comes the evolution of Hadoop. So Hadoop is mainly evolved to handle the big data and to process it into better decision making results. So how Hadoop started? So you all know about Apache Software Foundation. So that has been formed in the year 1999. So Nudge, created by Doug Cutting and Mike Cafarella. So Cutting and Cafarella formed the base for the Hadoop architecture. So in 2002, they created a project by name Nudge, which used a Google file system to handle the data and also to handle web pages and to analyze web related documents. So in the year 2002, this was started. And in 2006, Cutting joins Yahoo. Cutting is the name of the person who formed the base for Hadoop evolution. So he joined Yahoo along with the project Nudge in the year 2006. And after that, in the year 2008, the project was divided into Hadoop, and we have Hadoop in hand. So since Cutting is in Yahoo, was in Yahoo, the official release of Hadoop was given by Yahoo as an open source project, and that was to Apache Software Foundation and this Hadoop based startup Cloudera Incorporated. So in the year 2008, official release of Hadoop was done. Then Cutting leaves Yahoo for Cloudera in the year 2009. And we have commercial Hadoop, which is used by all the organizations around, in the year 2011. Then the release of Hadoop along with the distribution and pivotal HD technologies, everyone was incorporated. And in the year 2013, it was started usable. So this is the evolution hierarchy of Hadoop. So coming to Hadoop, what is Hadoop? Why we go for Hadoop? So Hadoop, as we saw, it is a framework that is used to store and process big data. So it is an open source software framework, and we process big data in a distributed environment. So as the diagram denotes here, Hadoop feature starts from its open source characteristics, reliability, economic, scalability, flexibility in usage, easy to use, data localization, high availability of the data for processing, distributed processing of components, fault tolerance. So these were considered as the main features of Hadoop architecture. So with these features in hand, Hadoop evolved as a framework for processing the big data. And we insist for distributed environment because our data is massive and it is enormous. So we process the big data in a distributed fashion. So Hadoop is a kind of distributed processing framework. So coming to the architectural components of Hadoop, Hadoop has mainly four distinct components. So right from MapReduce, it has HDFS, YARN framework, and common utilities. So this common utility is mainly used for storing libraries and other modules that is necessary for integrating your data and other processing elements. So the storage component what we have for our data is your HDFS. HDFS stands for Hadoop Distributed File System. So we have a HDFS evolved from Google File System. So this is in distributed fashion. HDFS file system enables you to store the data in a distributed environment. So this is the file system we have at the base. So this will be taken as the data storage unit. So once the big data gets in with HDFS, the processing over the data will be taken care by the MapReduce programming part. So MapReduce is the computational task what you have for the big data that is stored in HDFS. So as the name indicates, map and reduce will be the two distinct tasks that will be performed in this programming environment. So it is capable of performing large scale data processing. So it is just a programming model. And the left out part here is YARN framework. YARN stands for Yet Another Resource Negotiator. So we have resources distributed, both the processing and the data what you have or in distributed environment. So for resource allocation and for resource monitoring, we have a separate entity called Hadoop YARN. So this is exclusively used for monitoring and allocation of resources. So put together, all these four entities will be basically forming the components of your Hadoop environment. So whenever we go in with the overview of Hadoop architecture, we have the two basic components to be MapReduce and HDFS. That is, in normal terms, we can say that the front end and back end part. Front end will be your MapReduce, which is used for the processing of all the data, and your backend will be your HDFS, that is data storage. And for supporting these two entities for a particular computation or for a particular application, you have YARN framework and the common utilities. So this is the overall sketch of your Hadoop component. So coming to the processing wise architecture, what is the actual processing done under the front-end portion and back-end portion? So as we have seen, the back-end portion will be your HDFS layer, which is used to store the data. And at the top, you have MapReduce layer that is used to process the data what you have in HDFS. So under HDFS layer, you have the data stored in name node and data nodes. We will see a detailed explanation over the name nodes and data nodes in further slides, upcoming slides. Just to have you an overview of what is the processing architecture, this slide is given, right? So HDFS has the data, and the data is stored in the form of nodes called as name node and data node. And you can identify from the picture that there is only one name node and you have n number of data nodes. So this is a mandatory condition where in a cluster, you have only one name node to be the master, and that takes care of all the data nodes below it. And this is the backend architectural part. And at the top layer, you have MapReduce layer exclusively for processing the data what is stored in HDFS. So in MapReduce also you have the task tracker and job tracker. Job tracker will be acting like the master, which schedules the task to the task trackers, and all task trackers will be responsible for executing the tasks given by the job. So this will be the processing level architecture of Hadoop. So next, coming to Hadoop cluster. So normally in a distributed environment, when we connect one or more computers, we will term that to be a cluster. Cluster in the sense a group of computers to a particular task. So here also in HDFS style or Hadoop platform, we have Hadoop cluster, and each Hadoop cluster will have the HDFS component and the MapReduce component. And that HDFS, you have name nodes, and MapReduce will have job trackers. So here name nodes in turn will be followed by the data node, and job trackers will also be having the data nodes allocated to it. So the data nodes will be splitted into different entities, and all that will be taken care or given to individual task trackers. So the data what you stored in HDFS, it is not like replication of data into data nodes. It is just splitting up of data into data nodes. So you have n number of data nodes here in this diagram. It doesn't mean that data node 1 is being replicated in the second rack, third rack, fourth rack. No, it is not the case. Since Hadoop is a distributed processing, you have, and the data what you have is in huge volume. The voluminous data is being splitted into different clusters and different racks within a cluster. So the data available to a particular task tracker will be processed, and the results will be given to the upper layer, that is the MapReduce layer. So this is the cluster wise component what you have in Hadoop. So the client application interacts with the name node and also the job tracker. Name node will concentrate with the data portion, and job tracker will be concentrating with the tasks. So all this data node and task tracker will be monitored by name nodes and job trackers respectively for a particular application. So coming to the main important part, seeing the architectural components as HDFS, MapReduce, YARN, and common utilities, let us first get into with HDFS. So as we have seen earlier, HDFS is Hadoop Distributed File System. So it is mainly responsible of data storage. So it is going to store the big data. The high volume data will be stored in the format of HDFS. And you can picturize that as a block structured file system. So block structured in the sense, each file what you have for processing will be divided into blocks, and the blocks will be stored within the clusters, across a cluster in one or more machines. And this allocation follows master-slave architecture. So master-slave architecture denotes that it will be taken care by job tracker, task tracker with relevance to your MapReduce level, and name node and data nodes with reference to your data level, that is the lower HDFS level. So your cluster has one name node, and you also you can have n number of data nodes. So as only one master is allowed, you have name node to be the master for a cluster. So this is the architecture what you have for Hadoop distributed file system. So as you can see in the diagram, the upper part have the name node, and below that you have common data nodes. So the name node will be acting as the master here, and here we have n number of data nodes. So what is the processing, how data is going to get stored in HDFS means, whenever you have the files break up into chunks of data, we have name nodes and data nodes, and all the data nodes will be kept in racks, rack 1, rack 2, rack 3 likewise for each of the client applications. And the racks may or may not be within a cluster or across clusters. So all the data nodes will be taken care by the name node. So each and every data node will report to the name node, in fact, for the processing of the data, what it is being stored. So any read or write operation, what you have from your client application will be taken care by the metadata operations from the name node. And name node will instruct what is the name and what are the replicas, in which racks the data are available, and the corresponding data will be fetched for the read operation. So whenever a client application tries to write something, say for example, I am going to give a write command to a particular data, both in rack 1 and rack 2, the data which is available in rack 1 and rack 2. So in order to avoid inconsistency, we need to make sure that there is updation in both the data nodes. So the write operation will be generated or will be triggered for both the data node present in rack 1 and also in rack 2. And the updation will also be reflected in both the cases. So name node will have the metadata, that is information about all the data nodes which it's being processing, and also the path to each and every data node. And the data node will be having the actual storage unit, and it will be taking care of all the operational part, that is read and write operations. So this is the performance-oriented architecture in HDFS. So what is name node? It is a centralized master node. As we have seen in the diagram, it is only one name node for which you have several data nodes. And name node is responsible for storing the metadata. And the main functionality of name node is to check whether the data node for which it is being the master is alive or not. So the health status of its data node and the task which is to be given to each of the data nodes should be taken care by the name node. So that is the response have for name node. So monitoring the health status and also to assign the task to the data nodes, we have name node. And data node is the actual unit of storage, and it will be called as slave nodes. We have several slaves for a master. And what is the responsibility of slave node or data node here is, it has to respond its status to its manager or to its master, called as the name node. So it responds the task status and also its health status. Health status in the sense whether it is in alive condition or whether cases, the health status will be updated to the corresponding name node. And this sort of updation, that is updation of its health status and also the task status, will be carried out through a process called a heartbeat. So for specific intervals, the heartbeats should be raised and it should be given to the name node. Upon receiving the heartbeat, the name node can make sure that the data node is alive. If there is no heartbeat, that data node or slave node will be considered as not operational or dead. And apart from name node and data node, we also have secondary name node. So secondary name node is not duplication of name node. It acts like a buffer. So it is buffer to the master, and this buffer is used to store the intermediate updates. So intermediates update of all kind of processing within the name node will be taken care by your secondary name node. So this is the pictorial representation of name nodes and secondary name node. So whenever we get in with HDFS architecture, we have only the name node and data node components pictorially represented. But when comparatively seeing with name node and secondary name node, we have this secondary name node to be acting like a buffer. So it will be having the similar structure of the name node with the edit log and fs image. And fs image here stands for the directory structure, all file structure of that particular name node, right? The data nodes, what it is going to monitor, will be updating the copies of the directory structure, and that will be kept as an image, fs image, in name node. And name node also has the edit log entries, which keeps track of the heartbeats of its slave node. And after the secondary name node completes the fs image of all the data nodes for which the processing is being done, the final fs image will be updated in the corresponding name node. So secondary name node will be acting like a buffer that is used to store the intermediate results and to finalize the name node with its fs image. So the log also will be updated with the new edit log. So this is the correspondence what we have for name node and secondary name node. So that is with the HDFS architecture. So the storage part is with HDFS. And now coming to your MapReduce programming part. So MapReduce is the front end or the upper layer over HDFS. So this MapReduce is a software processing model which processes the data what we have in HDFS. So specifically, MapReduce programming is written in Java, designed in Java programming language. And as we have seen earlier, it is a combination of map task and reducer task. So what is map task? So this MapReduce programming is mainly for programming with the data which is splitted across clusters in distributed fashion. So we have HDFS, that too in distributed environment, and the data is splitted across the data nodes, across the clusters or within a cluster, within racks. So to process all those data and to get into the programming parts, the client application or the program will be reduced, or I mean will be segregated into map task and reduce task. So map task will be taking the data and it will divide that file into chunks, and they will be converted into a new format such as key value pair, and that will be given with the data nodes. And reduce task will be the next part of map task, where the key value what is framed in the map task will be reduced as tuples. Tuples here denote a single record. So the application what you have will be splitted into map task. So map task will have n number of segments for individual statement of an application. And that n number of segments will be given to the HDFS architecture, that is to the corresponding data nodes. And individual processing will be done. And the collective n number of data units will be put together under reduce task as a single record. So the input what you have will be split into different map. So that will be taken care by the map task. And each map task will be given with the reducer task to generate the final output. So map task is exclusively for dividing your programming logic or the dividing your file chunks into different split ups and allocating the actual data nodes. And reduce task will be After computing all the results, the reducer will take up all the processing intermediate elements and form a tuple or a record based upon the data what it has. And it will be taken care by the output format. So map task and reduce task are the two important tasks that is we have under MapReduce programming model. So in Java, we have mapper and reducer class to be represented for MapReduce programming. So mapper class will be taking the input and the input will be divided. That is the logical representation of the data will be splitted into blocks of chunks of works that contains a single map task. And for a single map task, we will have the input split. And the record reader will be responsible for interacting with the input split and converting that input split into key value pairs. What is the key and what is its corresponding value? So that will be taken care by the record reader. So mapper class main functionality is to split the input based upon the record reader. And the output what is generated from each of the split will be taken as the intermediate output. That intermediate output will be given to the reducer class. And finally, after getting all the intermediate inputs from different reducers, the process will generate the final output. And the final output will again be stored under your HDFS. So to trigger mapper and reducer class, we have the driver class. So this is responsible for entire setup of your MapReduce. And this driver class will initiate mapper class and reducer class in a programming environment. So this is one example what you have for MapReduce programming model and well-known example. It is word count process. So assume that you have specific set of inputs where it may be a text document or several text documents. And your processing is to find out the occurrences of each word. So assuming that in a text document, I have three sentences, deer, beer, river as the first sentence, car, car, river as the second sentence, and deer, car, beer as the third sentence. How I am going to use this MapReduce programming model? So as we have seen before getting in with the mapping, your record reader and input split will be taken care of. And the record reader will read the text document line wise. So here, each and every sentence is as taken as the key value pair. So first sentence to deer, beer, river to segregate with specific map one. And for the second sentence, map two. For the third sentence, map three. So mapping task, we will be again having that input split. So first key value what is generated will be the entire sentence and that has been broken into individual map task. And within the sentence you have spaces and the words count will be taken as the mapping part. So deer one, beer one, river one. And for the second sentence you have car individually, river one, and finally for the third sentence, deer one, car one, beer one. So mapping task will form a list of key value pairs, and after generation of this mapping, you have a shuffling process where all the words that are distinct are segregated. So when you look into that diagram, under shuffling part, we have the list K2 again with the vector. So you have, the value V2. You have beer 1,1, car 111, deer 11, and river 11. So you have a shuffling process here, which segregates the words separately. And finally, this processing intermediate results will be given to your reducer portion where the reducer portion will try to combine in the sense reduce the values accordingly. So beer 1, 1 has been merged or combined or reduced into 2 and car 3, deer 2, river 2. So for each of the map task, what we have under the first splitting process, we have generated the corresponding reducers output. So the first thing will have the output of a single word beer. Similarly for the second, third and final outputs. So with these reducers generating the intermediate results, that all will be combined to have the final results together as a document, and that will be getting stored in your HDFS. So this is how we process with MapReduce, and this MapReduce will be applicable to the processing environment where you have enormous amount of data to be processed, and that enormous amount of data and its processing gets segregated into different entities of map and reducer part. So under map part, you have the splitting of your key and value pairs and the mapping part. And in between that map and reduce, we have a shuffling portion. And this shuffling portion will be responsible for generating the results for your reducer part. So this is the overall view what we go, see under the MapReduce programming environment. And each of this task elements can be programmatically written using Java language, and that too with mapper class and reducer class. So how to segregate and read sentences, segregate that into individual words, everything programming code will be done with that mapper part, and reducer part will be taking care with the final reduction or combination of the similar key values. So for mapper and reducer, we will be giving code to do the task which is required for the client application. And for these two, mapper and reducer, we need to write a driver program to trigger both mapper and reducer. So this will be the entire programming structure for having the final result. Coming to the next part of your Hadoop component, that is YARN. So as we see, YARN is yet another resource negotiator. So here, monitoring of resources, allocation of resources will be taken care by YARN system. So here, both the MapReduce and the HDFS, what you have, process with front-end and back-end data. And YARN will be responsible for allocating resources to both HDFS and MapReduce. So we have the resource manager. Resource manager will be the master component here for a cluster. So this manager will be handling with all the nodes. And for each node, you will have node manager. And node manager will be acting as the slave for your resource manager. It monitors the status of the container and the application manager. So what is container? Where you have the actual processing, that is MapReduce processing. So that will be embedded within the container portion. And the app manager will be taking care of data processing, whatever is given by the container. And it also requests the resources, container resources from the resource manager. So whatever resources the container requires for processing, that will be taken care by the app manager. Then that request will be passed to resource manager for resource allocation. And this resource manager will be monitoring all kind of resources that is required for your container. So only in the container, your actual MapReduce task will be performed. So each and every node status will be updated, and for a particular node, the node manager will be responsible, and all the node managers will be updating the status of your MapReduce programming to your resource manager. And for the performance of the task what is allocated in the container, that is the actual programming task, we have the resource manager. So resource manager will monitor all the resources that are required for your MapReduce environment. So this is the functionality of YARN, yet another resource negotiator. Next, coming to Hadoop ecosystem. So far we have seen the basic main components of Hadoop architecture. So we have Hadoop ecosystem, and not only with the HDFS, YARN, we also have n number of components that form your Hadoop ecosystem. So MapReduce is the actual programming part what you have for the HDFS data. Data will be stored in HDFS. And for resource management, as we have seen, we have YARN. So these three components form the base for any kind of Hadoop architecture. But for other kind of processing elements, say for example, I have to do data analytics, I have to write query languages, I have to add another kind of database. So individually, all these will be given as an ecosystem components. So as given in the diagram, for analytical processing, that is for data analytics, we have exclusively Apache Hive component. So if you want to process any kind of analytical operations over this, you can get in with Hadoop Hive. So Hadoop Hive and Drill are the analytical components which works for the data analytics portion. Then you also have Spark and Mahout for your machine learning components. So for machine learning applications, you can have this component. For scripting, you have Pig. And for NoSQL databases, you have HBase. And to give an introduction to NoSQL, as you all are familiar, big data is structureless. You may have structured data, unstructured data, and even semi-structured data. We cannot predict what kind of format we have when the data arrives in. So if this is the case, traditional way of allocating a row and column will not be sufficient for us to handle it. So your structured query language will not be enough for you to handle such type of data. So when your data is heterogeneous, that is, it is of different varieties, we get in with NoSQL. NoSQL is not SQL. It is not the case. It is just not only SQL. So apart from SQL, you can also perform other kind of operations. So one such database is HBase. And for HBase, you have columnar value processing under NoSQL. Then you have Spark and Storm. And basically, you also have OOSI for scheduling the jobs between the map and reduce programming environment. Then you also have SOLA, that is searching and indexing portion. So for resource management, you have YARN architecture. Then for storage, we have HDFS. So the basic elements, what is required for storage, resource management, and programming is HDFS, YARN, and MapReduce, respectively. All other components of your Hadoop ecosystem will just add into a particular application. Whenever you require some sort of machine learning techniques to be performed over the big data, you can get in with Spark MLib. Whereas whenever you want to perform analytical oriented operations, you can get in with the Hive portion. I am going to concentrate only with query languages and that too with NoSQL databases. If that is the case, you can go for HBase. So depending upon the requirement, you can choose any of the component of your Hadoop ecosystem provided you have HDFS, YAML, and MapReduce as the base. So we have seen the base components in detail so far. And all other ecosystem components are left to the programmers or applications to take up for further application-oriented processing. So YAN, HDFS, and MapReduce form the entire Hadoop ecosystem or the architecture. So these are the elements that we have seen in the previous diagram. HDFS, YAN, MapReduce. So these three we have seen in detail. And these three form the base portion of your Hadoop architecture. Then you have in-memory data processing for Spark. And we see that today Spark is getting more application-oriented and it is getting more famous due to its faster processing, because in-memory data processing is faster in Spark whenever you pair that with your normal Hadoop environment. Then you have Pig and Hive for SQL processing, that is data processing services for querying languages. HBase has the NoSQL database. And for machine learning, you have Maho, Spark, MLLib, Apache Drill for having query languages on Hadoop environment, Zookeeper for managing the cluster, Oozie for job scheduling, Flume and Scoop for data ingesting services. So these data ingesting services will be taking care with the conversion of your semi-structured and unstructured data into a structured format. So normally whenever you have the big data in hand, with one kind of processing, we have to convert that into a traditional structured representation. So that type of ingest, either as a key value pair or column value or like a graph, you have to convert that big data into some form wherein you can store that efficiently and you can go for the further processing. So that ingesting services data conversion will be taken care with your Flume and Scoop. And for searching and indexing, you have a separate component, have SOLR and Lucens. And finally, for monitoring and maintaining of clusters, apart from Zookeeper, you have Ambari. So with this, I have covered the architectural, main architectural components of Hadoop, and I have given an overview to all another components of Hadoop ecosystem. So I hope the session was clear, and to the extent I have given the overview of Hadoop architecture. So if you have any queries, you can ping me in chat window. Thank you for your patience listening. Thank you all. So I have a question in chat window from Ms. Vatsumati Mohan. Can we use Python for MapReduce? Absolutely, Python you can have for MapReduce. And since we start with Java and Hadoop is based MapReduce, Hadoop relevant MapReduce is based on Java programming languages. You have mapper class, reducer class. And we also have Python related packages for MapReduce. Yes, you can use Python also. Any more questions? No, efficient in the way it is with the programming code what you write. Python is easy to code, whereas for Java you have to use applications and classes, packages in a higher level. Python is easy to code. This is efficiency depends upon the coding construct what you have. Security problems also we should be taking care by the environment whatever you have. Security will be taken care by the program, individual programs. Map and reduce task will be with the application oriented functionalities. So for an application, it is the programmer's dependency to have more security. System configuration, yeah, that will be taken in the next session, I hope. You will have a demo session for this Hadoop architecture. So all the system configuration will be taken by the next resource person, those who handle that.
Dear participants, if you're having any other queries, you can ask in the chat box.
Once again, can you say front-end tools used in Hadoop from Vinodina? Front-end tools, front-ends are the map reduce part. Front-end here, what I mean is the programming part, what you have for your the data, what you store in HDFS. So that is the architectural component. Hadoop tools will be, you don't have specific front-end related tools that are used in Hadoop. So as you see in the Hadoop ecosystem, different types of components are used to perform different operations. Say for example, for data analytics, you have Hive. For querying, you have some related tool. That is a component. So when you look into the picture of your Hadoop ecosystem, you can easily identify which is coming under the front-end part. Mainly the backend will be with the HDFS. You have NoSQL and HDFS to be your backend. And all other part which you manipulate with the data analytics or programming models, everything will be coming under your front-end portion. Yeah, sure. PPT will be shared by the coordinators. Thank you, Natina. Thank you.
Ma'am, someone is asking another doubt in chat box. Kindly view that, ma'am.
Yeah. How to use free data centers? Free data centers. How to use data centers free? No, I couldn't get your question clearly. If I have understood that correctly, data centers is a separate or segregated from your Hadoop environment. CDC, I couldn't get you, Vasumati, ma'am. Data centers for processing in Hadoop, that will be taken care in the demo session, ma'am. You will have a clear overview over that. This is just for an overview of the architectural components, processing elements, programmatically whatever is required, that will be taken care in the another session where you have a demo on the processing elements of Hadoop.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation, ma'am.
Thank you.
The next session will be handled by Srinivasan sir from Velalar College of Engineering and Technology on the topic of big data tools. So, dear participants, kindly hold on. So the next session will be starting soon within few minutes. Thank you. Dear participants, the session will be starting at 3 o'clock. So you can all leave and then rejoin at 3 o'clock. Thank you.